And it is March 16th at UCLA, where it's a beautiful day. The sunshine is shining. Eat your heart out, New York. And we're going to hear a debate today on the question of gun control. Specifically, we're going to ask and answer the question, this house would arm everyone. I repeat, this house would arm everyone. On the affirmative, Lily. On the negative, Amani. Amani? Amani. Sorry. And our Hannah and her sisters will be tiny. Can you see her okay behind me?
Okay, so today I'll be going on the topic of the House will arm everyone, and this proposition is to be presented as a policy case in the affirmative. So in this brief, the Second Amendment I'll be referring to refers to the amendment found within the Bill of Rights stating that the right of the people to keep and bear arms shall not be infringed. And throughout my brief, everyone will refer to United States citizens of the age 18 and older who have gone through proper training, education, and background checks before obtaining a license to own and carry a firearm. Should I be able to prove that arming everyone will better protect United States citizens because guns save more lives than they take, and that arming everyone will prevent restrictions from infringing upon Second Amendment rights, then I will win this debate. So what is the problem? First, people are dying as a result of not being able to properly defend themselves in gun-related tragedies such as mass shootings, as well as in non-gun-related incidents such as rape and robberies. According to research compiled by CNN in 2016, tragically, on average, each day, 93 innocent Americans are killed with guns, and approximately 13,286 gun-related deaths occur each year in the United States. When it comes to mass shootings, which is defined by the FBI as any incident where four or more people are wounded or killed, there were 385 that occurred in 2016. That is more mass shootings than the amount of days that there are even in a year. Today, at only the third month of 2017, the United States has already seen 62 mass shootings, 10,365 gun-related incidents, and 2,648 deaths from such events. During these events, citizens could have benefited from carrying a gun to protect themselves instead of being left weaponless facing a criminal who has a gun. Citizens facing these non-gun-related incidents could still benefit from the right to bear arms. For example, rapes are another heartbreaking crime experienced by hundreds of thousands of people each year. Each year, approximately 321,500 people, including both men and women, experience rape. On average, 54% of these victims are between the ages of 18 to 34. Recently, a rape survivor, Kimberly Corbin, voiced her opinion on the gun debate. At the age of 20 years old, she was left blindsided and defenseless when a man broke into her Colorado apartment and sexually assaulted her for over 2 hours. Although her assailant is now serving 24 years to life in prison, she still struggles with depression, PTSD, and stress-related seizures to this day. Recently, a now gun advocate, she questioned former President Obama. She stated, "Why can't your administration see that these restrictions that you're putting to make it harder for me to own a gun or harder for me to take that where I need to be is actually just making my kids and I less safe? Not granting the citizens inalienable right to bear arms not only puts them in danger, but also presents the problem of violating the Second Amendment. Our founding fathers established the Constitution as a means to guarantee civil rights to each law-abiding United States citizen. The Second Amendment is one of such freedoms guaranteed. Such rights are still spoken of today, but unfortunately, as you can see, we are not receiving such freedoms. James Madison, one of our founding fathers, in the Federalist Number 46 Papers, discussed how the federal government would be unable to exert power beyond the powers enumerated in the Constitution. Therefore, as a means of protection, the United States would rely on an armed citizenry to protect themselves, their families, and the nation. Such protections guaranteed to law-abiding citizens are prevented from being realized due to current gun restrictions. Gun restrictions limit the ability of such law-abiding citizens to purchase or carry firearms, while people that are willing to break the law continue buying and carrying such weapons, whether legally or on the illegal gun market, which is another problem as well. The illegal gun market has allowed many to obtain arms while other citizens remain defenseless. According to the Survey of State Prison Inmates published in 2002, among juvenile inmates who have obtained firearms, 9% obtained them through stealing, while 28% gained them through access through the illegal market. Another issue that can be talked about is the media portrayal of guns, which has created the idea that guns should be restricted because of the number of lives lost. Interestingly, the media covers, the coverage focuses on this problem with guns and how the number of lives lost due to gun-related violence is reason enough for gun restrictions to exist. However, with this logic, cars and smoking should be banned first. Because, for example, in 2015, approximately 408,000 people died as a result of smoking cigarettes. In that same year, 38,300 people died from a car-related incident. In comparison, only 13,286 people died as a result of guns. So, how big is the problem? The number of mass shootings occurring in the United States has drastically increased throughout the years. Recent events include the tragic June 12, 2016 shooting that occurred in Orlando, Florida at Pulse nightclub. In such tragic events, the amount of lives lost could have decreased if the victim's right to carry arms weren't infringed upon. Also, it has been demonstrated that most gun-related crimes occur in gun-free zones. From 1950 to 2017, every single public mass shooting in the United States, except for two, has taken place in a gun-free zone where citizens are not allowed to carry guns. Criminals in these events benefit while the victims face the consequences. For example, The Diary of James Holmes, the 2012 Aurora movie theater shooter, was released just recently in 2015. The diary revealed how Holmes had strategically chosen the movie theater over an airport because of what he predicted would be substantial security in airports. In the United States, there's a wide availability of guns, but only a small percentage of population owns such firearms, which also leads to the problem. Also, although we have an excellent police force, with a rising number of crimes, relying on the police force is not enough. According to CS Monitor, it takes 10 minutes on average for a police officer to arrive, and a lot can occur within those 10 minutes. So why do we have this problem? As stated, infringing upon United States citizens' rights to bear arms has led to countless citizens not being able to protect themselves. People have been led to also believe that guns lead to more life loss, when actually it has been proven that guns save more lives than they take. Recently, a Harvard study conducted in 2007 proved how not only is there no positive association between gun ownership and increased violence, but also that guns save more lives than they take. The Harvard study interestingly found that where firearms are most dense, violent crime rates are actually the lowest. The media has also covered mass shootings and created increased support for gun control laws, but largely ignored stories of guns saving lives. For example, recently in April 2015 in Chicago, an Uber driver witnessed Everardo Custodio shooting his gun at innocent bystanders. The Uber driver got out of his vehicle and shot the criminal with his own gun. The driver used his weapon in defense of the lives of innocent people and saved many lives in the process. So what is the solution? All 18-year-olds and older abiding United States citizens should be issued a license to purchase a firearm for an authorized seller and carry a firearm after going through specific procedures. Proper education should be enforced in all schools in the United States from kindergarten through high school in order to help educate students on when and how to safely use a gun along with the potential dangers. Having classrooms cover lessons on gun safety and using guns for self-defense can help reinforce a safe image and message when it comes to guns, which helps decrease the violent use of guns in the future. Teachers should also emphasize that guns should strictly be used in absolute emergencies and only for self-defense. Training should also be a requirement, allowing 18-year-olds to safely learn how to use a gun before allowing them to obtain a license. Background steps should also be administered before allowing the purchase of a firearm. Citizens completing and passing all steps of this process must also carry a permit at all times if they plan on carrying the gun with them. So will this solution work? By allowing law-abiding citizens to purchase and carry firearms, this proposal ensures less deaths occur as citizens can defend themselves. So,
therefore, for all these reasons,
the House should arm everyone, and I now stand open to cross-examination.
Before you start, I just want to give a shout out to Lily. You noticed that she used the Chicago style of footnoting, where at the bottom of the page you can see the full citation. That's the Chicago style of footnoting. It's very helpful in a reader knowing exactly the full context of the source citation. That doesn't stop you from orally communicating the pertinent, you know, and Harvard study in 2017 concluded this. But it helps the reader to have the Chicago style used. So please use the Chicago style. Okay, let's start the cross X. Go. 3 minutes. 7:15, that's what she gets.
Okay, you said that 93 innocent Americans were killed with guns, and you talked about mass shootings in 2016 and 17. But who is responsible for these shootings? Aren't these shootings happening because people are being armed, which juxtaposes your initial stance that we should arm everyone?
Well, yes, this is occurring because those people have guns, whether obtained legally or through the illegal market. But whether or not we arm everyone, those crimes are going to continue.
Look
to exist.
At me, I'm the king. Thank you.
Whether or not we arm everyone, those crimes will continue existing. So isn't it better to arm those people, so arm everyone else, so that they can better protect themselves in such incidents?
So you want to arm everyone in society, knowing that the fact that they might or might not kill everyone, instead of, you know, issuing laws that you know, bring tests to mentally ill, kind of examine who's getting the guns. You just want to arm everyone since everyone's already going to commit the crimes. Is that your solution?
Well,
I contact you.
Well, yes, according to the statistics that I provided, and I'm sure you will go over as well, these crimes are rising and they're going to continue existing whether or not we have gun restrictions. The government has already tried implementing some, and the illegal market is going to continue existing whether or not there are restrictions. So it's better to arm everyone and have them prepared in case such incidents do occur.
Okay, you mentioned background checks. What some background checks don't really resolve the mentally ill or the people that have like racial agenda. So how do you think that the background checks are going to identify that, oh, this person is purchasing the gun to kill this person or he's crazy? How do you think that the background checks will solve this problem?
Well, the background checks will be looking specifically to see if they have any history of mental illnesses
or
crimes.
What if they're not diagnosed? Because most of the mentally ill people are not diagnosed.
Well, that has been proven to occur already. So in those cases, those unfortunate cases, people will be better able to protect themselves if they do occur.
Okay, you said that from the 1950s to 2017, every single public mass shooting in the U.S. except for two has taken place in gun-free zones where citizens are not allowed to carry guns. So in the past 70 years, only two mass shootings have occurred in gun-free zones. Is this information accurate, and how is it accurate?
Let me find the source, but yes, when it comes to mass shootings, not...
Only two in the past 70 years.
Yes, not other gun-related incidents. Mass shootings as defined by the FBI, where four or more people are...
We're not defining mass shootings. We're seeing the correlation of your, or the truth behind your evidence in your debate.
Then, yes, I will find the citation, but yes, that is true.
Okay, you said that you want to educate kids about guns. How would educating 5-year-olds or 10-year-olds about gun control or how to use...
So you can answer the question, how are you going to educate kids?
So are you, like, motivating them to use violence when they feel unsafe, like a 10-year-old to shoot someone?
No, we'd be motivating them to protect themselves in moments of self-defense where the other person has a weapon or is showing a clear intent to harm them. And educating them would help prevent... There's also been a lot of incidents where young children accidentally fire off a firearm. So to educate them on how to properly use guns, which would prevent those incidents as well.
Okay, thank you. Okay, the chair will now recognize the leader of the opposition for a speech not to exceed 7 minutes in length. Here.
I am on the opposition side. I'm arming everyone. Let's just jump right in. Every town for gun safety support says that every day 93 Americans are killed with guns. An analysis of gun homicide rates in developed countries, those considered high income by the World Bank, found that the United States accounts for 46% of the population, but 82% of the gun deaths, which means that the U.S.'s gun homicide is 25 times higher than that of other developed countries. In addition, the vast majority of firearms are held not by soldiers or police officers, but by civilians. The most dangerous gap in federal firearm laws today is the private sale loophole. Although federal law requires licensed firearm dealers to perform background checks on prospective purchasers and maintain records of all gun sales, it does not require unlicensed private sellers to do so. Unlicensed individuals transfer an estimated 40% of all firearms transferred in the U.S. According to the U.S. Department of Justice, in 2016, because federal law does not require universal background checks, individuals prohibited by law from possessing guns can easily obtain them and not be recorded in the federal transactions. As of September 2013, 67,000 firearms were listed for sale from private unlicensed sellers. A survey of state prison inmates in 13 states who were convicted of gun offenses found that 30% obtained the guns from a gun store, but nearly 96.1% of those inmates who were prohibited from possessing guns purchased them from unlicensed sellers. So how big is the problem? First of all, toddlers have been responsible for more shootings and more shooting deaths than terrorists. Since the beginning of 2015, there have been 52 toddler-involved shooting incidents in the U.S. In 2015, Christopher Ingram from the Washington Post said, so far, at least 13 toddlers inadvertently killed themselves in firearms, 18 more injured themselves, and 10 injured other people. On an average month, intimate partners in the U.S. shoot 50 women. According to the FBI supplementary homicide report data, more women in the U.S. were killed by an abuser who used a gun between 2001 and 2012 than the total number of troops killed in the action during the entire Iraq and Afghanistan war. Of those respondents of women who had access to firearms, 67% believed that their partners were capable of killing them. 34% believed that of those responsible whose partners had access to firearms said that the court may not be able to confiscate their guns. In addition, if anyone can attain a gun, that means people that have racial agendas or religious agendas can target people. For example, the Black Americans make up 14% of the U.S. population, but are victims of more than half of all the gun homicides. Black parents are nearly twice as worried as white parents to send their children to school.
Orla,
the number of Muslim Americans that have been shot ever since 9/11 has increased rapidly. For example, on February 10th, in 2015, Dia Shadi Barakat and his wife Yusser his sister Razan were all killed due to a parking lot dispute, but sources say that this was Islamophobic. So why do we have a problem? Only nine states require a background check. According to the United Senate, over the past 5 years, 15,000 ineligible buyers have acquired guns simply because the background check could not be completed within 72 hours. One of them was Dylan Roof, who killed 9 innocent churchgoers in Charleston with a gun he was ineligible to buy. Waiting for a background check, even if longer than 72 hours, is a minor inconvenience, far outweighed to the benefit of keeping lethal weapons out of the hands of dangerous people. Therefore, in 2015, U.S. Senators Richard Blumenthal, Chris Murphy, and Dianne Feinstein issued the Background Check Completion Act that would require complete background checks. However, it was not acted upon in 2015. 82% of weapons involved in mass shootings over the last 3 decades have been bought legally, according to a database compiled by Mother Jones. For example, on June 1, 2016, 2 men were killed in a murder-suicide at an engineering building at UCLA. Charlie Beck, chief of Los Angeles Police Department, said that Note began to unravel unusual violent plan with police on Thursday, discovering a kill list in the shooter's Minnesota home. He was heavily armed, and the guns appeared to be legally purchased. He had multiple magazines of ammunition and multiple loose rounds of ammunition. So what is the solution? The first solution that I propose, in addition to enforcing background checks on people that want to legally purchase guns, should go through professional investigators and psychologists that would interview them after they pass the background check. Many people may be psychologically unstable. They might not be diagnosed as mentally ill. They may be holding a grudge on certain people. They might simply feel unsafe. So an interview would identify the reason for purchasing the gun and their intentions. For instance, the U.S. media diagnosed shooter Adam Lanza with schizophrenia days that followed the tragic shooting of Sandy Hook Elementary School in Newton, Connecticut. Was Adam an undiagnosed schizophrenic? Psychology Today asked. Lanza's acts of slaughter strongly suggest undiagnosed schizophrenia. The second solution is to remove the protection of Law Commerce in Arms Act, which is a federal statute that provides broad immunity to gun manufacturers and dealers in the federal and state court. For example, in the Phillips v. Lucky Gunner case, the parents of a victim of a mass shooting in Aurora, Colorado, issued a complaint against the internet retailers because of negligence for without reasonable safeguards to prevent the dangerous people from purchasing the firearms. However, the federal district court rejected the negligence because of the PLCAA. The third solution is to pass a law that makes private transfers of illegal and all of the guns in the United States legal. Following this, it should be legal for the ATF to use computer track to track gun sales. Okay. so will the solution work? Upon removal of the PLCA, gun manufacturers will not be encouraged to enter the business of selling or manufacturing guns because their involvement would be a liability on what their customers do with the firearm. According to an undercover investigation conducted in the New York City, 62% of private online firearm sellers agreed to sell firearms even though their sellers told them that they did not know their intentions. In addition, records of gun ownership and computer databases would greatly increase the efficiency of tracing the processes. On a balance, gun control essentially decreases the death tolls and keeps people safer in America, and that is our essential goal. Therefore, the House should not arm everyone. I now stand for cross-examination and points of clarification.
Thank you very much. What was the time?
7:07.
7:07. Perfect.
So we have 3 minutes? Mm-hmm. Okay. So you stated that 82% of the gun deaths occur in the United States, and that the United States gun homicide rate is 25 times higher than that of the other developed countries. What do you have to say about recent evidence, such as that conducted by a professor of criminology and public policy teaching at the University of Brighton, who looked at examples of, for example, in Switzerland, where there were no gun restrictions, and in fact, violent crime rates were lower because people were able to use guns to defend themselves?
Okay, so first of all, comparing Switzerland to the United States is a huge and broad topic. Switzerland's crime rates are definitely lower than the United States crime rates. The United States population is much more diverse and much larger than the Switzerland's population, which means that it's harder to know what the intentions of the population is or are. So I don't see a correlation between Switzerland and the U.S. in any way possible.
Well, you also stated that you mentioned the private sale loophole and how nearly 96.1% of inmates purchase them from the illegal market. Despite the background checks and other solutions you provided, if such illegal loopholes were to continue, don't you think it would be a better solution to arm people to prevent their deaths in the situations where people are still able to obtain such illegal weapons?
Well, the states in the top 25% of gun legislation strength had 42% reduction in gun deaths compared with the states in the bottom 25%. That number included a 40% drop in homicides and a 37% drop in suicides. In absolute terms, the states with the strongest laws had 6.4 fewer deaths than per 100,000 residents than the states with the weakest. So,
well, what about in cases where, for example, even in non-gun related incidents where women, you mentioned, a large percentage of women are killed by an abuser, even in gun related incidents where the abuser is carrying a gun? What do you have to say about cases where women, such as the one I mentioned, Kimberly Corbin, were at a disadvantage because they were not able to carry a gun and protect themselves?
See, that's the thing here. When we are talking about arm everyone, what I'm supporting is arming people, because the Second Amendment does allow women and innocent people and, you know, peaceful people to be armed. That's their right. So women can be armed. It is their right. It is the Second Amendment. What we are arguing against is the mentally ill, are the people that have racial agendas, are the people that are dangerous, that have access to guns. So women can be trained to use the gun. They can own guns to actually support their, you know, their safety in cases of rape or if someone, you know, a burglar comes in to their house.
Well, even with restrictions as proven in the past, there can still be loopholes and people can still have access. So don't you think it's smarter to just arm everyone to prevent that and also provide an education and background screening, like you mentioned, that would prevent the mentally ill from getting such weapons?
Yeah, see, my solution tackles that. It includes private investigators, professional private, and psychologists that to interview the people that have already passed the background check. So let's say a criminal or a mentally ill person passes the background check, then he would go through another round with the psychologists or, you know, the professional people to determine what his intentions are behind buying the guns that he wants to buy.
Okay, that's fine. Thank you very much. Just a moment, please, Lily. chair will now hear some refutation, hopefully done in four parts. She said, I disagree, because, therefore, arm everyone. Hopefully it'll sound something like that. From Lily!
Okay, so my opponent Imani said, the guns have taken the lives of many innocent victims, for example, in the recent Dylan Roof church shooting. While such statistics are true, I disagree with the positive association between an increase in gun restrictions and decreased death. The solutions she provided, such as background checks, they may not be enough. The private sale loopholes may still continue. Criminals may still use gun restrictions to their advantage and shoot places where there are gun-free zones or where there are people around do not have not chosen to purchase guns. As shown by the Harvard study I mentioned as well, the 2007 study, guns actually do save more lives than they take. Multiple examples demonstrate this concept. For example, the Chicago Uber example that I also provided, where guns were able to protect people. Had the guy not been able to carry his weapon, he would not have been able to shoot back at the criminal and prevent the loss of many other lives. Also, even though she states that Second Amendment rights are being protected, the Second Amendment states that the right of the people to keep and bear arms shall not be infringed. And I believe that allowing for any such restrictions would, in fact, infringe upon that right. If we have citizens 18 years of age and older who go through proper training and education, we can reinforce the safe idea of guns and the use of guns solely for self-defense. And I think that would be a better way to prevent the amount of innocent lives lost. Therefore, for all these reasons, I believe that we should arm everyone.
Okay, thank you. What was the time on that rebuttal?
142.
142?
3.
143. Okay, thank you, Lily. You can stay over there, Lily. Oh. That's your seat. Okay, the chair will now hear a 4 minutes of refutation from the leader of the opposition, which should be in four parts. She said, I disagree because, therefore, don't arm everyone. Go for it.
My opponent Lily advocates the Second Amendment. She makes it a big part of her discussion. I disagree that the Second Amendment should use the Second Amendment as an argument that we should arm everyone, because we have a lot of people that have racial agendas against other people, and we have a lot of mentally ill people in America that, well, yes, the Second Amendment allows them to bear arms, but should they really have access to guns to kill other people? For example, in February last month, 2017, a man entered a bar in Colorado and shot an Indian man that was in the bar due to racial reasons. My opponent also mentions that media doesn't mention the lives that are saved by guns and only the ones that are taken by guns. That is fairly true, but for the media to encourage the effect of guns, the positive effect of guns on people's lives and how they save people's lives, would be encouraging people to possess more guns and it would be, you know, changing the whole topic of, yeah, let's arm everyone because there's no other solution. There's no police. There's no law enforcement. Another thing that Lily mentioned is that she wants children to be educated about guns in schools. I disagree because in America, 7 children and teens are killed daily on an average daily because of guns. Also educating children about guns will encourage them to maybe search if their parents have guns, see how guns work, and maybe possibly harm themselves and harm other people in the public. Therefore, we should not arm everyone.
Thank you.
Lily also mentions that she compares Switzerland and the U.S. to each other, where Switzerland allows people after they turn 18 to possess more than 3 guns, However, the discrepancy, however, I disagree, because the discrepancy between the American population and the population in Switzerland is way different. The crime rates are less in Switzerland. And in America, we don't really know what people are doing. We have a lot of mentally ill people. We have a huge population of the homeless. We have so many issues here and there that we can't really correlate Switzerland to the U.S. Finally, Lily mentioned that the idea of background checks. And I think that 82% of weapons involved in mass shootings over the last 3 decades have been bought legally, according to the database compiled by Mary Jones. So these people have been through background checks, yet it did not stop them from shooting other people and harming the public. Thank you.
Therefore, for all these reasons.
Therefore, for all these reasons, I think that we should not harm everyone.
Okay, you may cross the house, shake hands in the spirit of good sportsmanship, congratulate each other on a good debate. And you stay up there at the front for your feedback from the class. Thank you.
That was 3:15.
Thank you. What?
I get the papers for the
line. Oh, you need a ballot.
Mm-hmm.
You have more?
No, I got one more.
She needs one more after this. Okay. You guys can take a seat. Relax, yeah. All done?
Oh, yeah, all done.
Praise the Lord. I'm going to borrow my staple and do I have all the ballots? Thank you. Two more. Thank you. on a 5-9 decision, the decision goes to the opposition. We should not arm everyone. How'd you vote and why?
Hi, my name is Antonia.
Hi, Antonia.
I voted in favor of the opposition just because I felt like it was like I felt that it was very hard for the proposition to just like in general to make to give it like a guaranteed method of making sure that everyone who is allowed to have guns is like either sane or aren't charged by like racial hatred or anything. So
her vetting process you didn't buy in the first part of her case where she was going to have thorough background checks didn't persuade you.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, good. Yes, sir.
I voted for the opposition as well. I thought both speakers had some great points. Why I voted for the opposition would be because just had like points that were more clear and a lot of support for those points, and her cross-examination was very good, and she pointed out a lot of the flaws. Though you had some very solid points, like I mean, the Second Amendment, that I feel like you could have capitalized on a little more. Overall, it was both really good.
Okay, thank you. Yes, sir.
Hi, everyone. I voted for the opposition myself as well, and the reason why I voted for the opposition was because I felt like Amanda did a great job arguing most of her points. And, you know, the proposition did a great job as well, but like Peter said, I felt like the Second Amendment would definitely be something that you would pretty much put all your eggs into, just because it's something that everyone holds so dear to their heart, especially most Americans that do have guns. So because of the limited time that you put on that specific stasis, I felt like the table kind of shifted towards Imani's side.
Great.
Thank you.
Thank you for using the terminology from the text, too. Yes, sir.
Hey, hello. I voted for the proposition.
Name?
Hi, everyone. John.
Hi, John.
So I voted for the proposition. I really tried to sever my personal views from this and tried to like look at this as a ranking, you know, in isolation. And I felt that the proposition cited sources very well, and I was able to recall them. I think the opposition did as well, but I recall hearing Mother Jones, and I remember Professor Miller said that that is not a good source. So that was a fact for me. So that's how I voted. Thank you.
One comment I would make as an aside is that, they went shopping. They're supposed to listen to this debate. John just said he tried to put his personal beliefs aside. This is a rather radical proposal. Arm everyone, for God's sake? Everyone? And that was sort of what she was trying to play on. Everyone, even the mentally ill, even the racist. And she had some restrictions. She didn't mean everyone, and she said so in her definitions, but she never went back to it to defend her own restrictions. So it was a radical proposal just on its face. Arm everyone? Oh my, we all personally know some people that shouldn't have a gun, right? Yeah. Anna, how'd your sisters vote?
Oh, well, I couldn't tell you. I voted for the opposition. I think that both sides were really well researched, and both of your beginning, I honestly couldn't tell you both of your seven, like, they were really well,
Get it out. Take your time.
They were really well thought out, and they were really well researched, and you guys did a good job with those. I think what the deciding factor for me was the cross-examination, and the rebuttal was just stronger on the opposition side. So that's why I voted for the opposition.
Yeah. We've had this, and I'll just leave it a generic comment, but we continue to have this situation where we ask a process question and we allow the other side to sort of have a nice little 20 or 30 second speech that helps them instead of hurting them. So we want to try to avoid that if possible. Yes, sir.
Hi, my name is Trent. I voted for the opposition. At first, I was for the affirmative, just because I felt like they did a better job, like laid the foundation for their case, and they had a lot of good evidence in the way they presented it. But then when it got to like the whole cross-ex and rebuttal, and as the speech went on, you were fighting an uphill battle of like arm everyone, and you did like mention how you wanted to do some like background checks and other processes like that of vetting, but you never like hammered that in and like really went back to it, so that it's really like hard to vote in favor that everyone should have a gun if you don't like really hammer down on the certain processes.
Bad form. Yeah, I agree with you that it, she got pushed into a corner that she didn't get, come out of. Yes. Yes, please.
Hi, I'm Dora. Hi, Dora. And I voted for the opposition. Both sides had really good points, but what won me over was the cross-examination and the refutals. I feel like the opposition really defeated the affirmative side's points. For example, bringing up Switzerland, that was all that kind of hurt you because it was a big comparison.
Yeah.
And also, the opposition made it clear that arming everyone, like, even the children, would be hard, so...
One of the things that I've said in lecture and told my debaters and when we're arguing policy and looking for solvency is one of the ways that you can persuade your audience that you can achieve solvency is to find a parallel situation like another state that tried it and it worked. Hey, it worked in Arizona. Perhaps it'll work in Nevada. And that argument from analogy, of course, only works as long as the analogy is accepted and there's enough similarities. And of course, threw doubt into the relationship between the United States and Switzerland. Now, very quickly, can someone think of a defense that Switzerland is absolutely perfect, legitimate comparison to the United States, say that if it would work in Switzerland, it should work here? Can someone think of a defense for Lily? No? It's just indefensible. Yes, sir.
Well, I think it's interesting because people always use other like European countries as examples to compare the United States when they're saying, well, they have less gun violence, which must be because they have more restrictive gun laws. But then when you use an example of a European country that has less restrictive gun laws, you say that they aren't analogous. So I think that if you were to strike off Switzerland, you'd also have to strike off all the other examples in the OECD, which he's talking about, saying that we have a vastly disproportionate level of gun violence compared to them.
That's a good point, yeah. But the point well taken that I want you to get out of this is the argument from analogy is how you'll go about proving solvency in a parallel case. Yes, sir.
Hey, I'm Chris.
Hi, Chris.
Voted in favor of the opposition, and I feel like it was already a difficult thing to support if you're part of the proposition, because I understand certain points where more guns can actually, you know, help save people. I was in
theory, right?
In certain theories, but also in certain areas, you know, if you have a bunch of people armed with a bunch of guns in a supermarket in Texas, nobody's going to shoot up that place. But when you look at it from the stance that everybody needs to have a gun, I'm about to do a debate right now about the mentally ill, so no, like, not everybody should have a gun. And, you know, it's kind of an unfair topic, but I think they both argued pretty nice, but in the end, I went with the opposition.
Good. I thought one distinction that perhaps was lost on both debaters is in arguing the number of guns that were out there, we didn't often hear the distinction made on how many people actually carried guns. There are states now where we have examples where they are allowed to carry the guns, and you can try to make some extrapolations from those social experiments on is that helping or hurting the crime rate. Yes, sir.
Hello, my name is Richard.
Hi, Richard.
I believe both had good arguments, but I was in favor of the opposition. One of the main reasons was the Switzerland comparison. It just shut down very quickly. But, overall, I did like the opposition's arguments. And the way she presented herself was very, I would say, assertive. So, yeah.
Okay, let me try to understand your reasoning, Richard. By that implication, Lily wasn't as assertive, or she was a little more passive for your taste?
Yeah.
I don't want to put words your way. So you are saying that. Yeah, okay.
So I heard Imani's...
That's good feedback.
Yeah, I was just... I heard Imani's points more clearly. It's like... She was more, it seemed like she was more confident in what she was saying.
Okay.
So, yeah.
Good. Thank you, Richard. Yes, please.
Hi, I'm Elsie. I actually voted for the...
Liz the chips. Thank you.
...for Lily's side. I think the way I judged it, I think in the text it was called, like, the movement model, because she moved me most from my original beliefs, which were, like, I know we're supposed to, like, neglect, but...
Yeah.
...and hard. So she was did the most to sway me away from what I originally thought, and I think her points were actually flowed a lot better, and it was a lot easier for me to follow her train of thought, even though she didn't address some of the issues that Imani brought up, which I think if she did, she could have strengthened her argument a lot more, but overall, I felt like she did best to sway people to her side.
Okay, good. I think, I noticed that there were certain, let me just ask it another way, or let me put it another way. Did anyone notice any contradictions between positions people were arguing and what was being proposed, between what they were proposing and what their evidence actually said? Did anyone notice any kind of predictions? Yes, please.
Like
stand up for Jesus. Thank you.
It was kind of confusing arguing for background checks and arguing for arming everybody. Like, I thought that was, like, a huge contradiction, because why would you do a background check if you can't, like, just vet everybody?
Or arming for background checks, or advocating for background checks, saying they're bad, but then arguing we need more of them.
Yeah.
They're good, you know. So there's a little tension there. Yeah. Yes, please.
Hi, I'm Sarah. I voted for.
Hi, Sarah.
Hello.
You voted affirmative.
Yes, I did so because I feel like on both sides, while there were constructive arguments, I didn't see the arm everyone aspect of the argument. I feel like I heard a debate why guns could be good and why guns could be bad. There were some, I think, subtleties that, like, hinted towards why perhaps we should not give a toddler a gun, or why perhaps we should not give a mentally ill person a gun, but with an inevitable fact being that it is a constitutional right to have guns and that we do have a black market, I think Lily did a good job of defending a very difficult stance, which, as you said, is radical in itself. One point that Imani made that was a little bit unsettling for me was
was insulting for you,
no,
you
no,
said?
No, it was a little bit unsettling.
Oh, unsettling, okay.
Was Nick, or Lily made the point that we should educate children, and Imani said we should not educate children for perhaps those children could go about and cause further devastation, and I feel like that is such a slippery slope to say, because percentage of the time is education of what the rights and wrongs to something is produce a worse outcome.
Right.
I feel like it could very well produce a better outcome. Should a child know at a younger age, if you touch this, it could do this. And
you know the safety
so
of it.
Yeah.
So far.
So.
Good.
Yeah. Thank you.
Thank you so much for that. Yes, sir.
Yeah, my name is Obed.
Hi, Obed.
I voted for the opposition because I felt like they were more assertive. They felt more confident in their wording.
Say it again. I missed it.
The opposition was more confident in their wording of their brief. I felt like they were more assertive as well.
Okay, so you voted on just sort of the presentational level.
Well,
one seemed more confident than the other. Okay. You weren't here. You were out getting potato chips. Okay. Did we get to everybody? No, we didn't. Sorry.
Hi, my name is Jesse, and I voted in the opposition. I was very pleasantly surprised by Lily's presentation of the facts. Intuitively, we would think that when we say statements like arm everybody, like those are very fear-mongering responses. But I thought hers was very calculated and well-researched. And you leaned on a lot of on studies and constitution, which helped your argument a lot. Imani really came down on background checks. She also had good numbers, and I think she did a great job of tearing down the Swiss and the U.S. comparison. But again, I think Lily had the really hard stance because there's a lot of data available on countries that are low in regulation, or not low in regulation, that don't have too many guns, like say a lot of European nations, but there's not too much data available on nations that have guns everywhere. And I think the U.S. is probably as close as we're going to get for now.
Right.
And I also, but I chose to vote in favor of the opposition because I thought Lily's arguments were a little more theoretical, like this is how guns are supposed to work, this is how the law should work, this is what should happen. And Imani's was more practical. This is what's actually happened. People are fundamentally flawed. Some people can't handle themselves with guns. So me favoring the practical side, I voted for the opposition.
Good. Those were good reasons. Yes, sir.
Hello, my name is Chad, and I voted for the opposition.
Hi, Tad.
Chad.
Hi, Chad.
Yeah, I voted for the opposition because, well, at first I was leaning towards the affirmative because she talked about how she gave a good definition of everyone, like being like 18 over and like whatever.
Yeah.
But I think she should have elaborated more on that to defend what Imani was saying about like, oh, what about like, you know, racial issues and like whether mentally ill or young kids.
Right.
But I voted for the opposition because she like deconstructed her arguments, and I think she did a really good job deconstructing the solution, because she talked about like, oh, we can do like this and that to make a safer world, but she's like, oh, well, then like 80% plus are already like, they illegally purchased a gun, but mass shooting already happened.
Yeah.
So I was like, she makes more sense, so I voted for the opposition.
Okay. Sam, did you have a few comments you wanted to make, or?
I think everyone already said most of the things I was going to say, and I was distracted
by that? Okay, good. Let me in closing say that I thought that both sides did an admirable job under very difficult circumstances, because on one hand you had someone having to take the position to arm everyone. Oh, there we go. Okay. Arm everyone, which is counterintuitive, and that leaves the negative with what what is her effect? Don't arm everyone or arm some people? Because, you know, she was kind of like a lot all over the map because she was at one point said, of course we can arm everyone. We have a right to Second Amendment, right? We just have to do good background checks. And so I thought that we had the issue nicely vetted for everyone to hear. The one thing I was hoping Lily would mention or come across, did you come across any of the examples of the new holster and carry states and those new examples where there's been a real recent trend where states are allowing more and more people to carry guns in public visibly?
No, I didn't find too much on within state evidence, at least for
recent. Yeah, because that's going to be a real interesting test of does that work to reduce crime? And, you know, there's anecdotal evidence that, you know, a guy was in McDonald's and, you know, a shooter came in and boom, he put an end to the mass shooting. Oh, whoopee, you know. But we can't just go on anecdotal evidence. So, okay. Thank you very much. Let's have the next debate. Yeah. Free country. People are dying in Syria, so you got freedom and liberty. Can you put them in proper folders over there? Red one for there's three different things you're doing there, right? So so put one in one and one in the other and then mark it, yeah. Okay, we have a battery change moment.